IVM.
You know, when you talk about the creator economy, right? It's something that started off with a bunch of people who had access suddenly to be able to create content, put it out there without the barriers that existed before that. I mean, you didn't have to go out and get really massive equipments or figure a way to hire them from, get sets. You know, all those barriers that were there maybe 10 years ago don't exist anymore. And that's really what built out the entire creator economy. And what came out of that was a set of people who created stuff that they wanted to really focus on, what they really wanted to focus on at that point of time in their lives, and as they have grown and evolved, so has their content, and also their audience has evolved with them. And that's what makes the creator economy so interesting. I know I've said that word creator economy at least 5 times, but I think it needs to be embedded in our minds that it is an economy. It is built not just around a singular piece of content or a singular platform, but multiple platforms, multiple pieces of content, stuff that evolve from that content. And that entire ecosystem really then helps kind of build out actual businesses. Someone who's actually been doing that and has built that entire thing out is Ranveer Allahbadia, popularly known as Beer Biceps. I remember first seeing his video long ago when I was looking for some fitness videos, and then I've seen how his content has evolved and grown with him. He also started his company, which is Monk Entertainment, sometime back. And it's been an interesting evolution of someone who started off putting out videos almost as a showcase of a journey he was taking himself. And it's grown to where it is right now. So I thought it'd be interesting to kind of dig into the mindset of a creator and really understand how that evolution really happens and how that evolves, and kind of learn from that as well. I'm Varun Duggirala, co-founder and content chief at The Glitch, and we'll be right back with Advertising is Dead.
Every week comes a show where three people come together to tell you about stuff they like. A movie, a TV show, a book, and other stuff. Tune in every Monday on the IVM podcast app to IVM Likes. Batman approves this message. Thank you, Batman.
Welcome back to Advertising is Dead with Ranveer Allahbadia. I got that right. Yes. Also popularly known as Beer Biceps.
Yes.
Why did you call yourself Beer Biceps? How many times have you been asked that question?
I get asked that question every week in a new podcast. Basically, back when I started, the goal was I just want to do like fitness videos, and I'm gonna be the ultimate fitness guy.
Yeah.
Very soon, I realized that there's no money in that, and I also realized that life has more to it than just fitness and bodybuilding.
Yeah.
So back when I started, I was trying to stand out as the bodybuilding guy who also parties.
Also, you started off as an engineer.
Yeah.
And that's what do you have as much individual angst about engineering as I do? Because I went through that process as well.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think it's definitely mellowed down now.
Hmm.
But for the 3 years post-engineering, I did.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. I think up till a year ago,
mm-hmm.
I used to get dreams of waking up for EDC exams underprepared. EDC is electronic devices and circuits. FETs, BJTs.
I was trying to give a CAD exam. That software, I was terrible. You had to model something. I was the worst person.
I had this dream where I woke up thinking that shit, I've got a paper coming up and I'm not prepared. And then I realized, hold on, wait, I'm a YouTuber now. Mm. And like life is much,
much
chiller.
Much better. Finally. You know, I keep meeting creative people who've studied engineering, and every person says that I had to do engineering to realize that I want to do something really creative, because that is definitely not the direction I wanted to go in life. I'll count you into that party as well.
Yeah.
When you started off, how was that something you picked up naturally, or do you think that was, because I'm asking you this because as I was asking you before we started recording, vlogging doesn't come naturally to everyone, like present case.
Yeah, so honestly, part of me, I think this is just the one of those dark things that engineering does to you, where you start looking a little bit kind of, you look down on creative professions, like because your professors tell you that that's the way to think.
Yeah.
So no, that wasn't the goal of like, I'll do creative work after engineering. Mm-hmm. But I tried launching a fitness startup right after college. It mm-hmm. was a tech startup. It was an app. It was an Uber for trainers. So
oh, nice.
You sit at home and you call for a workout home.
Oh, super.
So that was the idea. Too many loopholes when you actually break it down. Now, one of the guys who we were going to, like one of our potential investors recommended that this is a fantastic idea, but you need to market it well. Mm. So why not use social media? And I happened to know how to edit videos from school. I just taught myself in school on my Mac from seventh standard and I had the same Mac. So I figured, wait, you know, it's the same software. Why not use 2007 skills in 2015? And I just started putting out videos and then started scaling up really fast. Like a lot of people backed it. I figured that YouTube isn't just about creating videos. You have to brand yourself, you have to publicize, you have to select your content really well, you have to put out that content really well. You have to have that little funny slash chocolate boy thing on screen. And all of it just came together and then I realized that this is a much better idea than Uber for trainers. So
also, I'd say initially it also becomes like you might, you know, you start putting stuff out and then you realize that at some point that, okay, now this is a consistent thing that you have to do. Or were you always consistent?
Yeah, I was always consistent. I had that, like, I mean, so
I enjoyed it.
Like, I mean, dude, after engineering, you...
See, this has become that. I always like to do this when anyone who's done engineering.
You pretty much, like, enjoy whatever you're given. If you're given something you actually enjoy, then you enjoy it 10x more than you would if you're not done engineering.
And also, you were at that, you know, interesting... It was an interesting time to put stuff out on YouTube in India, right? It was still, I would say, the early days when everyone started putting stuff out. And I remember I the first time I saw a video of yours was when I was researching creatine and whether it was safe to use. Now, you watch a lot of these international videos and you realize all the guys who are saying it's safe to use have extremely large veins popping out, and that does not seem like it is safe to use. But I remember watching your video and that's when I actually subscribed and I've also seen that over time, there was a point when you said, okay, fitness is not just the only thing, and you evolved it, but you've always had a certain mindfulness focus, right? And like self-improvement and stuff like that. Is that, just in terms of just passion points, how was there a structured way in which you kind of build that out? Or?
Dude, I think with YouTube, if you're doing YouTube in the long term, you have to put pieces of yourself out on the internet. And as a guy, I'm very like into self-help, self-improvement. I'm just naturally drawn to it. I've always been naturally drawn to it. And I feel it never ends. So I guess that's the mindfulness you're talking about. That's always been there. So even if we're doing a video on why you shouldn't use all kinds of supplements, at the end of the video, there's a message that says that, hold on, you know, there's more to life than just going crazy about spending money on supplements. And I'll say the same thing if we're making a video about how to dress for chubby guys. I'll say that, hold on, wait, there's more to, you know, patawing girls than just dressing well and hiding your body fat. So that whole element of feel good positivity, I think it's who I am and I just try putting it out.
And so if you fast forward today, and what I find interesting, and this is what I feel the most interesting part about the whole space right now, is that it's not just... It used to be, okay, if you had to get some kind of content out there, there were very clear players, larger players you look at. If there was, let's say you were looking at who are the people, even like creating stuff, you would need all those, you know, there were so many barriers of entry and stuff like that. And the growth of people like you have really has kind of changed the dynamic of what brands look at, what consumers look at and so on and so forth. If you look back at when you started and now, as your content also evolved, has the way you do stuff evolved in terms of how you look at it?
I mean, when I started out, it was just that, yeah, I have to do something with my life. That was the intent. I have to somehow figure out how to make money through this. Over time, once I figured, okay, money can be made, then it just became about scale. How can I make this grow bigger? That's when I started teaching myself business. One thing led to another. Now, even just for the video process, we have like, I think about 10 people working on a single video. So like a team of editors, team of like content writers. There's a team of like social media people.
From being just you with the cam.
Initially
you shot yourself entirely by yourself? Or
I shot myself initially. Then I figured I needed some kind of help. So I taught my maid how to use a camera. So, yeah, that's the story.
Did you give her equity? Was that the deal?
Well, technically I should be giving her some equity, but no.
Wow, that's a, Now, I need to know how you did this. Now, 1 second. Now, coming from a person who used to only work behind the camera, where regular people, like, I would not say regular, I would say people who have supposedly been trained to do this take a while to get the hang of this. How did you manage this?
Do you want me to break it down from a photography nerd perspective?
Exactly. That's the best way to
I
do.
Taught her what aperture, shutter speed, ISO means, and she figured it out herself.
Is she still a maid is my question.
Yeah, she's super smart.
She learned all of the advice.
I mean, I don't know why she's still very supportive of Beer Biceps.
Yeah.
And she kind of trips out on the fact that, yo, this started with you and me, man. And it's kind of ended up with like a lot of people around and you're still doing the same thing. So she's cool about it.
Yeah.
Still makes the best chai in the world. Yeah. So in a way, she's contributing to the video.
Yeah, there is a... Oh man, I can have a long conversation about just that aspect and how you managed to do that. But, you know, also there's a point, and that's happened with... So I don't use the term influencer that often as much as I like to use the word creator, because I think creator actually has a better ring to it in terms of what it means.
Yeah. Also, influencer has a negative connotation in today's day and age.
Yeah.
I don't embrace that. I'm happy to be called an influencer.
I think it's negative because there is... So, this is how I see it. And you should... I want your point of view. Is that you become an influencer by virtue of what you create. You don't start off by saying, mujhe influencer banna hai, which is the problem, is how I see it.
Mm. So, that, I mean, there are kids today who say that. Nahi,
what do you want to grow up and become? I want to be
an influencer. That's the vibe. But... Yeah. I think that, yeah, you don't begin as an influencer, you become one by putting out a lot of value-adding content.
Yeah.
That's a very simple definition of it. Yeah. That's how I look at it, man.
Yeah, and also like, because if you're just focusing on that aspect, sometimes you might lose out on creating stuff that's extremely genuine to you and being authentic. Because whenever I see anyone I follow, I notice that the best ones are the ones who are doing it and you know they're being genuine. They're not... trying to be someone else.
Yeah.
Generally, that's who they are and that's what really sticks out.
And they put out a lot of non-branded content. That's like a key feature. We see a lot of... in fact, you know, I don't know why. Like a lot of beauty influencers, a lot of fashion influencers, just putting out a crap ton of branded content where every single post is branded. So they're kind of sustaining themselves right now, but they're sitting on like time bombs in terms of if you don't create organic content today's day and age, which is... not branded, your blog or your Instagram page or your YouTube channel isn't going to survive.
And also, because if you are consistently going to keep putting up every single brand at some point, just from an agency perspective, I feel that what ends up happening is that what's the difference between any brand if everybody's going to the same set of influencers, right? Yeah. And at some point, I guess it will go in the direction of, okay, this influencer works for these brands and this and so on. So that whole endorsement model is where things are going anyway.
Yeah. So, you know, eventually, when we had started our talent management company, that was the gamble we had. We hope that the world of PR agencies and, you know, social media agencies figures this out, that there are people who actually have influence and then there is like people are just taking on all kinds of brandies.
Yeah.
And, you know, people are getting kind of rapidly educated about this concept. But in saying that, there are, I mean, that still happens today where you have people putting out every single, you have people putting out lots of branded posts and they're making close to like 15, 20 lakhs a month.
Yeah.
So even if their careers are over in 2 years, they're set for life pretty much.
That's also, it's interesting because you mentioned agencies. I feel most brands actually get it much faster than agencies do. It's been my constant point of focus to actually spell that out almost on, I think, every single episode I've said it at least. But because I feel that you're going into methods you are always comfortable using. So you will use an influencer like how would you would use a media spot and not necessarily understand that a media spot might somehow... be a thing, but an influencer is a person who has a certain personality. So unless you blend it into that, it's never going to seem like they'll just do it for the money. It'll go away, right?
It'll never
work with the audience.
So I mean, that's exactly what we are seeing as well. Yeah. Where I think a lot of people are stuck in that old mold of no, I just want to do influencer marketing, so I'm gonna throw it on these influencers.
Yeah,
but that's changing slowly.
Yeah.
So good. It's a and I'll tell you honestly, on this side of the court, it's a great space to be in. It's rewarding.
Yeah.
If you're putting out a lot of organic content, you're pretty secure in what you're doing. Yeah. But just keep doing what you've done till this point.
Yeah.
You know you're in a great place for your career.
Yeah.
And if you're in your 20s and you found your vibe, it's like a big blessing, man.
Yeah. Also, when as you start creating, initially it was YouTube, and then it spread across other social platforms and stuff like that, right? And or was it?
It was always YouTube with one other thing as the focus, which at that point was Instagram. Now I've taken on, because I mean my YouTube responsibilities have reduced in terms of I have an edit team, I have a recording team. I don't have a lot of hands-on work with YouTube, so I've also gotten deep into Twitter. So I'm primarily playing,
which I really enjoy, and I mean anyone tells me Twitter is not really a platform, I think there's so much scope to do stuff on Twitter.
I think people who don't enjoy Twitter follow the wrong Twitter accounts. Twitter can become whatever you want it to become.
Don't, and it's also reflection politics.
Sorry,
don't follow politics. You find best Twitter. That's the best Twitter is a non-political Twitter.
Twitter is also, it's a great reflection of your internal world. So if you're crying about Twitter, that means you're crying about what's going on inside here. But my Twitter is fantastic. It's all about, it's all these entrepreneurs just throwing self-improvement gyan, and I'm like, yes, give me more. That's how I opened my Twitter.
And like you mentioned, at somewhere from being a creator, then Monkey happened. Do you call it Monkey or is it Monk Entertainment.
Monkey, like Bandar.
Monkey, Bandar also, yes. how did that happen?
So basically, I think, I'll tell you the long story is that I was training Tanmay Bhatt from AIB while I was a fitness-only YouTuber. And he had taught me that, wait, you know, you can make money through YouTubing and through brand association. So I knew I needed some help on my back end. I needed some management. And eventually, I mean, I reached out to a lot of agencies. No one was ready to take up this whole talent management game for me.
Things have changed.
Yeah, and the ones who did had a shady reputation. Like, so I was like, okay, I'm gonna stay away from that.
Yeah.
So I just went back to college one day for this seminar. So the guy who had organized the seminar was a smart guy I'd worked with in college, who's sitting right here, pretty creepily, creepily enough. But so he was this smart dude I'd like worked with in college, and I knew I had a work vibe with him in terms of, like, I knew my equation with that. With him, and then you have to translate well to work. So I asked him to just kind of get me brand deals then, and I was just switching into fashion from fitness at that point. So it was a fantastic point to get some money into the channel. So we basically listed down 10 brands, and we said that, you know, just reach out, cold email them and cold call them, which is a mistake. We kind of everyone just told us to, they just told us off basically. And eventually, we started cracking some deals. We cracked a bunch of deals. Our YouTuber friends saw us doing this. So they said, wait, why don't you do this for us as well? So it kind of turned into a talent management agency. And then we ended up working with a lot of brands on their influencer marketing campaigns and all that. So we figured that, wait, why not just become like this whole digital marketing company, which does talent management, influencer marketing, social media, all kinds of stuff. So now any kind of digital requirement, we have your basis. We have that game covered.
And that transition, and again, something which I was talking about before we started recording, also then kind of, because till then it was, you're focusing on the content you were creating with you in it, around you and all that stuff. And then the whole balancing kind of comes into it. Right? Then, because then there are terms like HR and finance and admin, which are things with the bane of every entrepreneur's existence, which kind of come into it. HR actually not as much. HR is your 99% of your job anyway. So balancing that out, how did you see that happening for you?
So I think
you had a co-founder, which is a good thing.
Yeah, and my co-founder and myself, we divided our responsibilities really well in terms of, hey man, I'm the YouTuber and I'm going to be the face and you do everything else. Like, no, it wasn't that. It was like, we divided in a much cleaner way, but in saying that, he actually did everything else. He did all the boring stuff. He's also like the heartbeat of the company. I figure that because I'm a creative professional, I'm going to do creative strategy. I'm going to do a lot of the content strategy. I'll keep helping him wherever I can, and I will help with like the whole networking of Monk Entertainment. So that's how we divided initially. The only trouble I had in balance in this whole thing was, I was able to do YouTube, I was able to do this, my personal life and all took a hit.
Yeah.
Which is fine, because if you're a 24-year-old, I think, and if you've got an opportunity, make the best of it. Yeah. So, no complaints.
When did you start off?
I was 22 when I started Beer Biceps, and I was 24 when we started Monk Entertainment.
You also went through a phase in between, and I remember watching this video you put out, I think, recently about how at some point you tried to rebrand yourself from Beer Biceps to just your name, and then now you said, no, I'm just going to be... You went through a Dwayne Johnson phase, basically. That's what you went through.
Okay. So basically, I'll tell you. Now, I've figured...
I'll tell you why I'm asking this question. Because yeah. I'm also... I find it interesting about how online identities work around actual people and their names as well. Yeah. So that's my...
Yeah. I've basically gone for these treks in like very remote villages. And I've had these Adivasi kids come up and say, hey, up to Beer Biceps. And I'm like, yo, that's cool translation of my brand. But I'll basically give you why I rebranded myself. Around a year and a half ago, I figured that Hindi is the future of online content in this country. And I wanted to switch and create a Hindi channel. So the game was, should I be putting up Hindi videos on this current channel, which has a primarily Indian audience?
Yeah.
And should I be just calling it Beer Biceps Hindi? Should I be leaving it Beer Biceps?
Yeah.
Then the answer was no, because I also had an audience from the South and Northeast who aren't big fans of Hindi. So I definitely had to start a new channel. I was going to name it Beer Biceps Hindi, but, and I'm going to be straight up here about this, the Indian middle class really rejects anything associated with alcohol or partying, like most of it. And urban audiences enjoy the name Beer Biceps because they're like, oh, that's new and it's catchy and all that. And rural audiences will tell you, chalo, like they'll just be like very, like, you know, dismissive of your name. So I thought at that point that it's fantastic to just name myself Ranveer Allahbadia. And that's what we still call our Hindi brand.
Okay.
So there is a second channel called Ranveer Allahbadia. There's an English channel called Beer Biceps. Beer Biceps is a name I'm not, like my heart isn't there anymore because I don't drink anymore at all. Yeah. Because of like, that's another conversation.
Okay.
Like because of all the meditation and all in my life. And I'm not into bodybuilding anymore. I still work out. I enjoy working out. But I'm not a bodybuilder. So,
isn't it much better?
Isn't it like much better like
than bodybuilding? Then
hell yes.
I find training a lot more fun.
Oh
than
yes,
this is going to become a fitness podcast in the next like 30 seconds. But literally, like, I went through this whole bodybuilding focus phase for years and trying to like bulk up and do this thing. And literally, like about a year and a half ago, I said I will just do training, and I've just literally used the Nike training 100%. App, and it's been one of the best things I've done.
Bro, I also feel it, especially in an entrepreneur's life, it becomes that one escape.
Yeah.
Where there's no numbers or strategy in the gym. It's you and your muscles.
Yeah.
So I completely.
Which is why I can't do trainers anymore.
Yeah.
And I feel really bad because I had a trainer for almost like 6-7 years sporadically, and he comes to the same gym and he looks at me with this like, oh, you've you know that ex eyes where he's like, oh, we were together, but you now you're by yourself. I'm like, I'm just not cheating on you. I'm doing this by myself. I'm not like with someone else. But yeah,
You know, dude, I don't do trainers anymore, and I don't do conversation in the gym. Like,
I cannot do conversation in the gym.
I just put my headset on and I am gymming and listening to a lot of Drake, a lot of Kendrick Lamar, and lifting.
Metal is my thing in the gym. I old school metal and like go like full rage. I call it rage therapy. It's my favorite kind
Slipknot.
Of thing. Basically, thank God for Spotify. Spotify picks. I literally play a couple of songs and it just becomes those. Literally, 4 out of my 5 mixes that Spotify has given me are only metal.
Nice.
So I don't have to go look for it. They figure things. Getting back to what you're talking to, while this digression goes on and on. So building out the company at some point, has it also evolved the kind of content you create post that?
Yeah, 100%. Because you get so much perspective, man. Like,
yeah.
Feel like just living out these 2 years of creating the company has been an MBA in itself.
Mm.
Learned so much. So my Hindi channel, again, it's not just fitness, fashion, all that. Do a lot of entrepreneurship-based videos, a lot of personal finance videos. Mm. It's kind of grown-up content, you know? Like, I think I've gone from being a boy to becoming a man through running this business.
So, as you grow, you evolve with it.
Yeah, pretty much. Also, as a YouTuber, you got to do it, dude.
Also, your audience evolves with it.
Exactly.
You, yeah.
So, I've been super conscious of that from the start, that, wait, I cannot keep making fashion or keep making grooming content.
Yeah.
These guys have gone beyond that. Now they're all well-dressed and all sexy looking. Now they want to earn money.
Yeah.
So teach them that.
Yeah.
And I know what the next 2 or 3 waves are going to be. So I have it like kind of chalked out. And I followed my chalked out plan until this point, and I intend on following it for another 10, 15 years.
Yeah.
So let's see.
Talk about chalked out plans. How often do you sit down and say that, okay, these are the... So if I'm coming from someone who used to work in a television channel, and I always felt that creating content online has been that how you program a channel is how you TV channel is how you program that, where you need to have a couple of big pieces that you do in a year, and a lot of smaller pieces across the way, and you kind of build that on your own personality. This is literally that, right?
It's exactly what you're saying. Mm. There is a content strategy.
Yeah.
There are even videos where I don't hit as hard in terms of I won't put in my best effort because maybe I'm in a rush, but there is that pressure as a YouTuber putting out content.
Yeah.
So I won't ever repeat content. That's a big taboo for me.
Mm-hmm.
But I will repackage it in some way or add some other aspects to that same piece of content. Yeah. So that you have to put strategy in place and you have to have those show card videos in terms of things that you know will do well, which actually requires you in your offline life, like outside of YouTube, to hustle hard. So for example, I knew I wanted to start a podcast with famous personalities, and when you're talking about fame in India, it's about Bollywood.
Yeah.
Now how is a 23-24 year old YouTuber going to reach out to these Bollywood celebrities who are so far away?
Yeah.
So starting Monk Entertainment, that was one of the games in my head that wait, I will build something big enough for people to take notice and then have a team constantly reaching out to people, which is exactly what happened. So now when the time to start a podcast came, I had my weapons ready.
Yeah.
So always planning. You've got to like look at three steps, four steps ahead. I know what I'm going to be doing 5 years from now. I know one of the projects I'm going to be working on. It's probably going to be some kind of a web show.
Yeah.
And I've already started chalking out those ideas in my head, man. So
how has the podcast scene been? How have you been enjoying that?
Reviews have taken a big hit in terms of it's not that people don't like it, but when you start uploading a new kind of content piece on your channel, the YouTube algorithm relearns your channel. Till now they were used to say like 7 or 8 minute videos twice a week. Now it's suddenly this 55 minute 1.5 hour long thing once a week. So it's a whole kind of your wiring everything on your channel. What's happened is that the views have dropped, but the audience retention has increased, the watch time has increased, and in terms of the people who come up to me on the road, people are deep into the podcast. So podcast just like kind of helps people stick to you as long as you're providing fresh content every week. So that's the challenge I have to face, that can't just call Bollywood people.
So you have to unlearn some pieces, you have to relearn some parts.
And you have to be able to take that punch of, as a YouTuber, you get addicted to views. And if you see a drop, it's very demoralizing.
Yeah.
That's the benefit of having two channels as well, that if I'm getting a drop on this channel, then I'll just make some ladkiyon ko kaise pataye video on that channel and I'll get a million views. So it makes up for my view quota for the week.
You know, a lot of the stuff that you're saying, right, what's interesting is the fact that it's not just about the journey of when you start off to how your content evolves. It's also the stuff you do around it that evolves, like everything from how you use data, how you kind of build out the scale of the content that you're creating, and all the other periphery stuff. I want to get into all of that because there's certain points I wanted to focus on, but I do know we need to go in for a break. So we're going to do that and be right back with Advertising Is Dead.
Hey everybody, welcome to another amazing week on the IBM Podcast Network. If you're not following us on social media, you know what? I'm tired of asking you to follow us. This time I expect you to follow us. Please make sure you follow us. If you're not following us, I'm not going to talk to you anymore. Seriously, I'm sure many of you would like that, but that's the only threat I have. We'd also like to thank our sponsors of the network this week. Thank you, Storytel. Thank you, Intel. We're really grateful for your support. On Advertising Is Dead, Varun is joined by none other than Ranveer Allahbadia, better known as Beer Biceps in the digital space, also the host of our short-lived podcast, Hustle Science. On Paisa Vaisa, Anupam is joined by Ashutosh Shrotriya, business head at Religare Insurance Company. They talk about health insurance and how to choose a good insurance plan. On the Empowering series, Zarina is joined by Ambar Qureshi, founder of the Plum Tree and former plus-size model. They talk about body positivity, self-belief, and the idea behind starting her own clothing venture. On Paperback, Rachita and Satyajit talk to Gyan Nagpal, the author of The Future Ready Organization. They discuss the new strategies that can make every element of an organization productive and how we can break the hierarchical structures within. On Heal and Hearty, Rachna is joined by two working professionals, Navaneel Kar and Manvi Patak, who talk about how to maintain a work-life balance and a healthy lifestyle. On our Kannada podcast, Thalle Harate, Rohit Shenoy sits down with Ganesh Chakravarti and Pawan Srinath to talk about primary education in India and Karnataka. This week on Edges and Sledges, Ashwin, Varun and DJ talk about the India vs. Bangladesh first day night test at Eden Gardens. On Golgappa with Tripti Khamkar, Tripti is joined by Indrajit More, content creator at Bharipa and Bhatupa, who gives tricks and tips to travel on a shoestring budget. On the Filter Coffee podcast, Karthik is joined by angel investor, business and strategist Lloyd Mathias. Lloyd talks about the technological entrepreneurship space in India, things to look for potential investments, and how brands should be transparent with their communications in order to create a strong identity. On Mr. and Mrs. Binge Watch, Janice and Aniru talk about the highly rated show this year, Succession. On 9XM Soundcast, Eva is in conversation with Bollywood singer Palak Muchhal. She has lent her voice to movies like MS Dhoni, Aashiqui 2 and Prem Ratan Dhan Payo. And with that, let's get you on with your show.
Welcome back to Advertising is Dead. We're still with Ranveer. Okay, so before we went for a break, right, and this is something which I wanted to ask you. A large part of the audience of this podcast are people who want to kind of work in the media space, want to get into the whole advertising, marketing, entertainment space and all that. But also a lot of them have actually kind of write in from time to time saying, okay, like, you know, I recently had this boy who wrote in he said that, you know, I want to work in this space. Should I just create stuff and put it on my YouTube channel? Because I don't know who will see it, but at least it can be a way for me to showcase it. Most people worry about starting off. I think that is the most, like me, right? Someone told me the other day, you run a podcast, why can't you put out content separately? And I said, I don't know if that's something which I would do, because it's innately not something which comes naturally to you. What do you say to that in terms of what's the starting point?
The best advice I ever got in my life was just start. Like, I remember after we met that investor who recommended that we get into social media, my co-founder on that startup was my gym coach, who had been a mentor to me also.
Mm.
And I was sitting on his bike and we were going back home. And I told him that, you know, sir, I want to do this, but I don't have a great physique right now. I had a good physique, even like shirtless. I had abs and everything.
Yeah.
But I just didn't have those veiny bodybuilder arms that you were talking about.
Yeah.
So I told him that, should I just wait and bulk up a little bit and then start? He's like, no, just start right now.
Mm.
Just jump in, because you will make mistakes initially.
Yeah.
So the sooner you start, in fact, the faster you learn, the faster you become
better. Most of those channels have veiny guys only. So at some point, someone wants to say, okay, this guy actually doesn't seem like it is entirely faked up.
And that's what worked for me.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't know that based on my own 21, 22-year-old perspective.
Yeah.
He just told me, jump, threw me into the water, which is the best thing I ever did. I also believe that if you have, I was very hungry at that point in my life, because everything I'd done had failed.
Yeah.
Like, I'd tried doing one course, it had failed. Tried going for a job, it had failed.
Yeah.
So I had to do something. I had too much energy to do shit.
Yeah.
So jumping in and just starting out is the best thing I ever did. That's what I always tell someone who wants to start creating in the media space.
Mm.
Also, there hasn't been a better time than this day and age to create something cool.
Yeah.
Especially on YouTube, people think that the YouTube game is over and you can't enter. That's not true. The truth is that the English YouTube game is dead in this country.
Yeah.
So if you want to create English content, good luck. I don't think it'll work.
Yeah.
Hindi, regional, and by regional, I mean any Indian language, including like Assamese or Marwadi, anything will work. But just create regional.
Someone
content.
Asked me if I'm on TikTok. I said, I don't know what I would do on TikTok. That is not necessarily what I would do.
Yeah, I created a TikTok account. I grew to like 800K followers.
Oh.
Yeah, that's another conversation though.
That's a platform which I find so intriguing to watch.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Not necessarily create, but I don't think I would ever. But I.
I don't do the dub smashes. I don't do the dubbing and all that.
But I'm saying that is the, I would say, truly mass platform from like initiation, right? Niche took on later. It's the entire flip of what every other social platform was. That it started off, you know, metros and English and all that stuff, and then went mass. And here you like every the content you're seeing is like, I mean, how are people even figuring out how to use this so quickly, right? Yeah. You know, there is also this whole barrier piece when it comes to brands, right? And I think I know a lot of people saying, okay, like you said, you approach brands, you cold emailed them, and at some point it started becoming a larger conversation. How have you seen how brands work with you from let's say the early days to now? How has that kind of changed?
Early on, we had to like teach people about influencer marketing. We have to explain what it means.
Don't copy paste. Don't give me the copy. Don't send me a script.
Even like tell brands that this concept exists. It wasn't like, you know, even like modify the definition of it. It was give them the definition.
Yeah.
So it was very early stages of influencer marketing when I started. Now it's like we get like 50 emails a day saying, oh, this campaign, that campaign.
Yeah.
Now it's a crazy world.
But how do you filter that out? How do you make sure that the because this is something which I've heard many brands say, right? And which is where I find this the influencer marketing space, I would say interesting. Because
shady.
I won't say shady, because I feel that most people are used to doing it in a certain way. Mm. So what ends up happening is, oh, this is the post, will you copy paste and put it out, which is the worst thing to do. But how much time are people investing in making sure the content you actually create is engaging enough and authentic enough? And I see that still gets lost. And I've heard many brands turn around and say, oh, I don't know if the influencer marketing I do works, or maybe I shouldn't invest as much in it, but we'll do it anyway. Now it's part of the media mix, right? It's become that. So you put it out there. But have you seen brands evolve enough to understand what they have to do in that?
Young brands for sure. Hmm. Startups for sure.
Yeah.
Startups listen, like, you know, they'll listen to the perspective of an influencer, because see, the truth is, and this is not me being pompous about being an influencer, but if anyone's grown a significant online following in numbers, above 500k on YouTube, above 200k on Instagram,
yeah,
you've done something correct in your life. Mm. Like, you're putting out some kind of correct content.
Yeah.
That means you have some perspective about how to market yourself on social media.
Yeah.
If you can market yourself, you can market almost any product that fits in with your personality.
Yeah.
So brands that take feedback from influencers and moreover just give you the freedom to execute it in your way, those are the best campaigns that actually convert to the best sales, the best numbers for a brand.
Yeah.
But you need to be able to have the balls to give the, you know, responsibility to the influencer.
Yeah.
We reject most of our incoming brand campaigns, either if we don't believe in the brand, like if it doesn't fit my personality, or if they're coming in with their like concrete brand campaign in the head, this has to be done in this way.
Yeah.
And if we know that this is not going to work, then why, we don't want to be a part of that campaign. And there's like enough brand campaigns out there, you know, to find something to sustain yourself every single week.
Which is the problem I find with especially traditional advertising, right? And them evolving is been the fact that you have built out very strong brand mandates and brand things over the years, and that are definitely worked. But you need to also learn how to add some flexibility to it, kind of widen that.
Mm.
I mean, don't make that barrier so strong that the fact that you can't, like, I remember there was a campaign which we once said no to, but we had to really fight it hard, was the fact that it had to be in someone's house.
Mm.
And it had to be a real person story. Mm. But the brand man, the colors of that house did not match the colors of the brand. So they said, can we just make a set and put them there, and we fought it, right? And that is many times, it's I would say now tougher for brands, for agencies to have that conversation. I think it might be simpler for influencers to do this, because you are in at the end of the day the creator of it, right? And you're also the media vehicle of it. Do you also then see if on the other side with the agencies, when you work with agencies directly as well? I still believe most of them haven't learned, but what do you feel?
Yeah, the same. Next question.
That was quick.
No, I'll tell you.
Which is why this podcast is called Advertising Is Dead. That's literally the reason why it's called that. It's because the old way of doing things has died.
And you know why that is though? Like, I feel, as you called yourself, early millennials and actual millennials.
Elder millennial. I'm an elder millennial.
Elder millennials and normal millennials have grown up in the decade where we just discovered social media and social media just came up.
Yeah.
Now that has had an impact on our mindsets. Yeah. And this is something that people in their 40s today haven't had in their life. So they don't understand. They come from a different world, different past. Advertising, the world of advertising, the world of agencies caters to that audience, which is kind of old school, without understanding that this new young millennial audience thinks in a different way, wants different things, has different attention spans.
Yeah.
It's a whole different game, which only a millennial or an elder millennial will be able to understand.
And do you spend time with, let's say, the influencers you sign on and stuff like that, also kind of explain the fact that where they should really draw the line? Because sometimes, I mean, when you're starting off, you can't blame people, right? When you start off, you are seeing money being offered to do certain things, and so then it might just affect how you are.
Coming back to my responsibilities on Monkey, any talent we sign is always mentored by me. Like, at least I'll have one mentoring session with them. So I'm kind of, have you seen Hitch, this movie Hitch?
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm the Hitch of like talents. Like, and that's actually what my life is like. And that's also kind of what my content is. Like, I'm the Indian Hitch of digital.
That is such a nice way to put it. Damn, I come up with a better designation. I was told that my designation right now has issues because it has content in it. Because I find content is such a wide word now.
Yeah.
It's like, what are you going to put into it?
Mm.
How much you guys use data and analytics and stuff like that?
on Beer Biceps or on Monkey?
In general.
Beer Biceps all the time, in terms of I have to understand what the audience is liking. And early on when there were just 10 videos, it was way easier to just understand, okay, this is what's doing well, this is what's not.
Yeah.
Now there's so many videos and there's a whole library online.
Yeah.
So you have to go and see what people are watching today. And a lot of people watch my fitness stuff even today. Where are the fitness views coming from?
Yeah.
Weirdly enough, all my fitness content, which I stopped putting like 2 years back, is being watched by today's 40-year-olds, 50-year-olds who've discovered YouTube now and who've discovered health problems now. So they want to take care of the health. Yeah. So you discover all these little nuggets of gold in your analytics. In terms of Monk Entertainment, I mean, it's a business. So in the world of modern businesses, analytics are a part of our life. Yeah. We have a guy who's just dedicated to that in office. Yeah. So that's being studied all the time. Every single different team in Monk Entertainment is studying its own analytics.
Yeah.
But I'm not the guy to answer that question because I'm the creative co-founder of Monkey.
Yeah.
And not Viraj. So get him on your podcast and ask him.
Get Viraj on this one. Also, as you kind of, and we briefly spoke about this before. Actually, no, before we started recording. Going ahead, how are you seeing this, both how you kind of evolving and how the company's kind of evolving? How are you seeing that?
Last 2 years of my life, I've really dedicated to Monkey in terms of made a lot of like, I personally feel like I've made like a lot of sacrifices with my own time, with my own priorities and all. I've always put Monkey in front because, have you heard of LeBron James?
Yeah, of course.
He's an NBA player.
Of course.
So I'm deep into like LeBron's mentality.
So I listened to this podcast called the Nike Train podcast. He was on their last episode that came out. It's great listen because he's generally like...
Yeah. I'm sure. I know what it'll be about. I've heard a lot of LeBron podcasts. Yeah. Different stages of your life, I feel you have different idols.
Yeah.
And he's been someone I've been very naturally drawn to for the last 2-3 years because of the whole leadership aspect.
Yeah, yeah.
So for the listeners who don't know about him, basically Michael Jordan was considered the greatest player of all time.
Yeah.
And he became the greatest by playing isolation ball, which means he made his team win alone. Like he would he would score all the points. Yeah. He would do
Sachin,
everything.
Sachin, basically.
Yeah. And LeBron,
from Indian cricket context.
And LeBron came in like 2003 and changed the game by focusing a lot more on making his teammates better, assisting more than scoring, but also being able to score like Jordan, but choosing not to. And so I was in that zone with life about Monk Entertainment. I do feel it's time for me to become scoring LeBron rather than assisting LeBron now. So what I'm doing is I'm taking a step out of Monkey. I'm giving more time to Beer Biceps and Ranveer Allahbadia, the two online brands. I just feel at this stage it's correct to do that. And in saying that, I want to launch more businesses. You know, maybe a clothing line out of Beer Biceps. Maybe like my book is coming out next. I've written a book on health, which I've not been able to really kind of just put those finishing touches on.
Yeah.
All that kind of work needs to happen now.
Yeah.
Monkey working on it was super fun. The most enriching experience of my life, even more enriching than Beer Biceps.
Yeah.
So, but that phase is kind of over. I've decided I'll be going to that office once a week. Otherwise, I'll be working out of my garage.
Ah, perfect. So back to base.
Yeah, back to basics.
But not with your maid camera.
Yeah, now we're gonna have a nice swanky
garage over there in that sense. Yeah, what you're saying is an interesting evolution, right? Because that has been the bridge which I many times have encountered with anyone who's a creator going towards a business, is that at some point as the business stabilizes, and this is something which I don't think it's even about being creator, it's even as I think as an entrepreneur as well, there comes a phase when companies require different things, and once it comes to that phase, there are different people who actually run a lot of it. And like I glitch right now, like I would say my responsibilities are far lesser than they were, let's say, even 2 years ago. And I think that's a natural evolution of things. I also have to say evolve as an individual and kind of, not to give gyan, but to just simply help in better ways, and better use your time in that sense of the word. How do you see your content beyond this evolve? When I say that, so because you've covered all the buckets you would see across, not I wouldn't call it self-help, but I'd say self-improvement in that sense. What have you not covered in terms of a bucket that you feel you want to cover?
I've not covered personal finance in as much detail as I'd like. I've not covered spirituality at all. I've not covered yoga at all. And just these three can sustain me for the rest of my life.
Yeah.
But there's lots of other topics, including... I know that at some point, if I become a parent, I'll become a parenting YouTuber.
Ah.
Basically, whatever's happening in my life...
I can give you many points.
You should start a parenting channel.
That I should start a parenting. You know the thing. Actually, wait one second. You can be interesting. You know there are zero resources except for one website called Fatherly, which I found much later.
Oh wow!
Online for fathers, nothing.
That is
you can try stuff. And find stuff for moms. There is so much out there. I found an app, the only app I found for fathers when we were expecting Leia was something where basically every day would give me one tip. And it was a funny app. So every day say, oh, today don't do anything wrong. Or like today don't piss her off. She has enough on her mind right now. I'm like, that is the only thing. And that's really the gap, right? I mean, wow. There's nothing for fathers.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's the...
Yeah, yeah. And I know that if I legit run out of content, I've learned so much filmmaking on this job that either I will transition into web content, like some web show, or I will start vlogging.
Yeah.
Like, I have this urge to direct movies, direct films.
Yeah.
And I know that that's going to be a transition at some point.
Yeah.
But there's too much self-help content to put out right now.
Define the right way to vlog, since you mentioned it.
Fast, for sure. Mm. Don't fuck around like with your time, or respect your audience's time. And secondly, put value in your vlogs, you know. Don't just talk about, oh, today I ate this and, you know, tomorrow I'm gonna go and meet him. Like, put some shit out. Like, if you're thinking about some deep shit, make a whole vlog about that one thought, which is how Casey Neistat, the world's greatest vloggers, grown. Every vlog had value add.
And what I enjoy the most is just the variety of shots and I think that's also the problem with, and see, what I just said is also the problem, right? I remember when I was recently trying to put up a video, I spent about half an hour trying to figure out what angle was right and eventually didn't do it. And I think that unlearning of that process of people who especially have ever worked in video is the problem, because naturally, I don't know how to frame myself. And I know that that's the first problem.
But I'll tell you the bitter truth of vlogging. As much as you and me as lovers of film would love to create good looking vlogs, it's about getting people addicted to you. So even if you put out shit, but put it out every day for a year, that'll build a bigger audience than you putting out fantastic content, but putting it out only once a week.
The problem with watching Gary Vaynerchuk is this, is that when you watch too much Gary Vaynerchuk in life, and he always has D-Rock around to shoot him. And that is the innate problem with that. Because someone the other day said that Gary is literally one of the only people in that space, which is why he does so well. Is just he shoots himself so well.
I'm gonna get a D-Rock at some point. I've been grooming a couple of
them. I wonder how he does it, and that's also the question, right? And I've actually asked, so I asked people who shoot stuff for celebrities, because I think that's a different ball game from working with, let's say, who someone's a creator or an influencer. Because celebrities, generally, you are doing all the, you know, you're just covering, right, and documenting. It is 24/7 you're shooting a person, right? And I remember talking to a guy who does it for Tiger Shroff, and he's like, that guy was in it. Like, he was doing like animation and CG work and like lots of funky shit, but he was enjoying it. And I'm like, it's a different trip that he's on.
There's a lot of hungry filmmakers in India today, dude. So even the guys who work with me, to be honest, they've seen me for 4 years, same guy on screen, same fitness. They've seen that same shit for 4 years, but they're still like into it. So there's just hunger in this city. You know, it's a beautiful city to build media careers. I know for a fact at some point when I decide to move out of my garage once again, I will have that system of a dude who's just with me in my car. And we'll be creating Gary Vaynerchuk style content. I might sell, you know, the stuff I've built and go to Fiji. And just live there and do nothing.
Why do you want to be a monk?
I've got this deep, like, spiritual aspect of my life that I don't even talk about online. I mean, like, people know about it.
You don't have to talk about it if you don't want to talk about it.
No, I'll talk, bro. When I started Beer Biceps, I happened to discover meditation. Got very deep into it. Like, I mean, I've reached a stage in my life where I meditate for 2 hours daily today. And it's a very big part of my life. There's been, everything has kind of been tweaked around that. I've stopped eating meat. I've stopped drinking alcohol. It's even aspects like I don't get angry anymore. I don't allow anger to rise within myself. A lot of it has helped me in business, given me too much internal peace. And I've interacted with a lot of monks. I've interacted with a lot of people who are spiritually like very advanced. And they have a kind of higher understanding that a lot of human beings aren't even perceptive enough to get. So I'm also reading a lot of spiritual books. I'm naturally drawn to that kind of life. And as I'm growing up, as I'm getting deeper into the spiritual journey, I'm also seeing that I'm less drawn to materialistic, material things.
Yeah.
Monkhood is something of like I'm seriously like thinking about. Yeah. But first need to build a lot of businesses and become a cool, positive, motivational speaker. And then do the monk stuff.
You know, towards the end of every episode, right, we do this one thing which is called the Humans of Advertising. Where it started off as my own weird version of the Coffee with Karan coffee quiz, but it is not. It has never stuck to that. It is never rapid. It is not generally random. It goes into tangents in conversation between that as well. But also just kind of find stuff which you wouldn't necessarily ask regularly. What are you a fan of that people wouldn't think that you'll be a fan of?
Basketball, like deep into basketball, like deeper than you think. I can go on one of the shows and host them. Like I'm deep. Yeah, I'm as deep into basketball as I'm into YouTube.
Oh wow, that's a
I never played in my life. Like
what?
Just
why wouldn't you? I get that. Like,
yeah.
I love music. I've never played an instrument in my life.
I actually discovered it pretty late in life. I've always had like one sport I followed a lot.
Yeah.
Since Beer Biceps started, for some reason, I've just been very drawn to it. Yeah. I'm also deep into video games. Mm-hmm. So there's this one video game which I'm really hooked on to call NBA 2K. Mm-hmm. It's the best sports video game ever made.
Yeah.
In terms of I've played FIFA all my life. And the moment I discovered this game, I stopped playing FIFA. I was just like, wow, what have they created here? It's incredible. It gives you a real experience of what it's like being an athlete.
So I got out of gaming a while back because I could not do consoles, right? I recently discovered all these surreal games. Like there's this game called Inside.
Okay.
Which is this really dark game of this kid in this dystopian world who's trying to just go across. And there it's very dark and very twisted. And it's creepy to the extent. So this creepy
no, I like it.
Dystopian game trip of late. Listen to a lot of podcasts.
Not anymore because I'm running my own and now it's like too much podcast in my life. Used to listen to a lot of the Tim Ferriss show, Joe Rogan Experience, Indian podcast, Vishal Gondal show. Those are my three. Recently, no, not at all, because I am really studying this game of improving my own podcast.
What's your you've taken away all possible vices. What vice do you have left?
Probably video games.
Yeah.
And also...
That's not a vice. It improves brain.
On a human level, I feel I'm emotionally... kya bolte hain? I'm unavailable emotionally. Because there's just... Okay, honestly, there's businesses. There's all the salaries we pay. And then there's 5 million people looking up to me on social media, expecting the next video.
Yeah.
I start getting messages the moment we've gone 4 days without any video like on the Hindi or English channel. So it's a very like all eyes on me situation.
And how do you do that?
Sorry?
How do you deal with that on a day-to-day basis? How have you learned to deal with that actually?
When it had started happening, it was a little overwhelming. I think the right people, the right mentors around you really like kind of anchor you down, give you a good mindset. Now I'm really enjoying the process. In terms of a cricket reference, I feel like I'm batting right now. And I'm in the middle. I've scored a 50. Now I need to go and get that 100.
Ah, nice.
So that's what's happening. I'm very locked in. Like I've lost relationships. I've lost friendships. But it's not something I've done maliciously. It's like I'm batting right now. Like I can't look at the dressing room. I'll come back there. But right now let me bat. So that's my zone in life.
Read a lot?
Yeah. A lot of spiritual
books. What do you recommend you read recently?
So I read a lot of spirituality. I used to read a lot of business books. But I gain more even from a business perspective from the spiritual books. The one book I always recommend to everyone on my videos on social media is this book called Autobiography of a Yogi. It was Steve Jobs' favorite book, Virat Kohli's favorite book. There's magic in that book. The book I've been reading recently is this book called Doorways to Light by someone called Krishnanand. He used to run this meditation school in Bangalore. So it's just his experiences in his deep meditations and all that. Incredible stuff. Very like, it gives you perspective beyond just material wealth and things like that.
And what can I whip up in an instant?
like what can I cook?
Anything. It could be food, could be a drink, it could be any. Actually, it's a very random open-ended question.
Beer Biceps began as a cooking channel.
Yeah.
So I can make some Michelin star level shit. I used to cook a lot of meat, a lot of red meat. Become vegetarian. So I can make a super sick Punjabi butter paneer.
Awesome.
I can make really sick chicken as well. Like, but just, I mean, that's beyond me now.
And why will advertising not die?
Because you've got young millennials who are excited about social media, creating YouTube channels and creating media companies.
And elder millennials too. I'm just going to add, bump that in there.
Yeah, yeah. All kinds of millennials.
Thanks so much for doing this, man. This has been fun.
I loved it, bro.
Thank you so much. And that's it for this episode of Advertising Today.
Awesome.
Hi, guys. This is Ayushi.
And I am Ritasha.
And welcome to Agla Station Adulthood.
It's a fun podcast we've got going on, and we'd love for you to tune in and enjoy with us.
Join us as we stop at various stations and discuss different topics that seem to be bothering us, and hopefully
dating,
you as
relationships,
well.
Relationships, beauty, just being an adult, lots of different things.
We don't have a great grip on it, but we've done okay so far.
Catch Agla Station Adulthood every Thursday on the IVM app, the IVM website, or wherever else you get your podcasts.
Hi, I'm Satyajit.
Hi, I'm Racheta.
We are from the Open Library Project, and we host a podcast called Paperback.
Paperback is a podcast where we engage with stalwarts and experts from various industries, suggesting non-fiction titles that contributed to their journey in a big way.
We've had guests like Anjali Rana, Dr. Marcus Rani, Dr. Swati Lodha, Ambi Parmeswaran, Apurva Damani, and many more on our show Paperback. Find new episodes every Wednesday on IVM Podcast app, website, or wherever you listen to podcasts.